Okay, Mithras, ancient god of ancient Persia. The area of Mesopotamia, all the way through the Persian area, what would have been Siam, and leading into India. He was seen as the successor to the Akkadian Age and the Phoenician Age that he showed up. Down here in the bottom right-hand corner, he's wearing one of those Phrygian caps. And interesting enough, you can get a lot out of things. This is a fresco from 300 BC. And so this is before Christ. But yet, here is Mithras in the middle. And what we're seeing depicted here in this picture is the fact that in his story, he is being baptized. This is something they have. He's being cleansed and baptized in the water by the shepherd man in the skins over here at the right. That would be very much like John the Baptist. And over here on the left would have been the creator of all God. And he is telling people that this is his successor, that he is becoming heaven, and that the guy in the middle, who is the son and his son, but he's also the son, and that he is to be his successor, his son, his forebearer. You see him with a halo on. You see the dove descending, which is a symbol of Inanna and giving her virtue. And in fact, she imparts the waters that anoint the Christ, who is Mithras. If you'll look at this, he has 12 disciples around him in a circlet. These 12 disciples are very saint-like, and they actually have different aspects to each one of them. And almost like Catholicism, you can use these guys and their teachings to help lead you to what the answer is with the one in the middle who directs everything to the Father. Sounds real familiar, and the iconography is real familiar. The problem that people are going to have with it is that it happened 300 BC or farther back. They find it all the way up until 300 BC or even after. Through that, it keeps going. It's interesting to find the parallels that he actually has with Jesus Christ. Oddly enough, I found a clip that came from a game show over in the UK, and it's one of those things where they give you a hint and keep going and give you a hint and give you and keep going. And of course, the first time that they gave him the things that go along with this guy, they chose Jesus. And then they were pretty much just dumbfounded after that. And so let's look at all the things that do go with this here real quick. This is again a game show from like the 80s, late 80s.
Media. There are amazing things claimed about Mithras, and I'll read you some of them. He was a savior, Mithras, sent to earth to live as a mortal, through whom it was possible for sinners to be reborn into immortal life. He died for our sins, but came back to life the following Sunday. He was born of a virgin on December the 25th in a manger or perhaps a cave, attended by shepherds, and became known as the light of the world. He had 12 disciples with whom he shared a last meal before dying. His devotees symbolically consumed the flesh and blood of him. Because Mithras was a sun god, he was worshipped on Sundays.
Is he a tribute band?
He with a halo around his head. And Mithraists gave each other gifts on December the 25th. The leader of the religion was called a Papa, and HQ was on Vatican Hill in Rome. And you know, you're kind of writing up the chat, and this is just a massive coincidence.
Yeah, just a massive coincidence. Yeah, just a massive coincidence. And you'd say that, well, they've got to be copying them and stuff and everything. Yeah, you'd agree that somebody's copying somebody when you find out Mithras is peaked at about 300 BC before any of the Christ things. And It actually came out of the sun god Shamash and the Babylonian aspects of things. It just really starts to, you know, make you wonder. It's from the Ahura Mazda strain and things. You can find that him and all through the Zoroastrianism and things like that, that people do try to equate that comes about. And equates to being, you know, the bringer of that, or where they must have just kifed most of it from. Surely they've got some difference. They go, we do this, whatever. The basis of it, the rest of it, you know. And there are literally hundreds of accounts that you can find that really correlate Jesus as a reincarnation of Mithra. That the whole dogma that goes with it, and everything is, you know, twisted, got a different flavor on it, but it's the same thing. It's like whenever you see somebody do a movie nowadays and you go, man, that's just like what you call it. It's what it is. And people, it is what it is, okay? But look at all these different types. There's just so many of these articles, books and things that really just set him to be a clone. And who was this Mithra? You know, let's look into this deeper. Well, Mithra starts showing up in Rome just right around the time of Christ, actually. And you know, like the map that I showed. And there are two different religions blended into one here that pull him as one. So this is Rome again twisting their 2-to-1 thing, like they did with the Greeks and so on. And there was this entity known as Sol Invictus. This is it, the god Sol Invictus, Dio Sol Invictus. And it means the ever or non-changing sun, the everlasting sun. There's a lot of ways to look at Invictus, but it's very strangely looks just like the entity that France gave us that we know as our Statue of Liberty. In fact, I'm of the belief that this right here, one of three statues really that are in Rome, are the inspiration for what we get of our Statue of Liberty. And indeed, it does have an incredible resemblance to our Statue of Liberty, down to the amount of points on its head and things. Of course, there's a few statues that have him with a different point count, but we're just going to go with 7 here, which is the sacred number. And definitely a Romanesque nose on this lady, even though she seems to come from France. But it is a Roman depiction of a giant Roman statue. This is a something that is equal to the Colossus. And some of the things that were considered to be the 7 wonders of the world at one time. And we've got it here on our shores, welcoming people as a beacon of new hope. And indeed, the Persian god Mithras, or Mithra is the Indians and Persians knew him, was the god of hope. And so let's look into this just a little more, this iconography we've been given to, so that we have symbolism. You know, Washington's full of symbolism and all kinds of Masonic things, and it lays out a pentagram and the compass and everything. But let's look at this statue a little bit. It looks incredibly like this statue found at Kalmar. Almost looks like somebody tried to recreate it, but just really put a sad look on her eyes. The rest of it seems to be the same, or seems to have a wanting gaze, or something that gives ease to you, and this one looks very much at distress. You know, I kind of get it here. Yeah, I can definitely see the resemblance there. Yeah. In fact, ours even looks a little more flat-nosed Roman-esque, you know, than the Persian one. But I guess that would be common, you know. Yeah. And it really rings true when you find other statues throughout over there where they're looking at this Mithras, a deity and the bringer of light. That he's known as the bringer of light. Light, by the way, is equated to knowledge. And so that definitely is showing through right there, that this symbolism that you see a lot. And you know, America and the world needs her knowledge, her light that she brings. And girl, put that arm back up there. I know it gets a little tired, but hey, they'll weld it in place, kind of like Moses having to have his staff held up at the big fight here. Let's get that arm back up. And you know, this grand lady Liberty of ours, she doesn't ever take a break. You know, she doesn't lower that arm. She doesn't just sit back and have that casualty. You know, it's about time for there to be some casualty, some not casualty, that's a bad word. It's about time for there to be some satiated time of. And you know, she doesn't take a break. She doesn't ever, you know, lower her arm and give that break. She's supposed to be a lighthouse and a beacon of light showing, you know, back towards the rest of the world. When the sun goes down, she's still there throwing the light back at them. Which, when the sun comes up on the other side of the world, they're getting it and they bring it to us and we throw it back around to them and they bring it to us and we throw it back around to them. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Yeah. It's about time we had a time of peace. It really is. You know, we all like our liberty and we all want our own liberty, you know, that we can call our own. You know, maybe it's time for mankind to kick it in high gear, you know, here and you throw the other arm up, really get that enlightenment going there. Although, look at her crown, it's even blowing her points back down. She's just caught in the wind. Yeah, believe it or not, this is on the other side of a Taco Bell someplace. And I believe it's someplace down near San Antonio. So, yeah, incredible. Yeah. And her original face was meant to be more stern looking like this, and really almost looks like a Elvis kind of mad, doesn't it? You see it? Yeah. But they changed it. Something that's much more solemn and has distant eyes, and instead of a stern look, a little more caring, and just a little bit less Elvis there, baby. She was originally supposed to be something that was somehow mocking the Colossus of Rhodes. This picture on the left is a little incorrect. His legs actually sprouted across the duct that you came through. And so people were actually going through the legs of him or whatever. But this is that same creature and entity that's all attached to this same worship thing. Shown again here in this, I believe, Italian example of the light bringer. And how she has broken the chains. See the length of chain in her hands, and she holds it out as if to say, "See, I have overcome." And of course, this is a female entity. This has all been ruined because the Bible has nothing but men in it, and women are just, you know, fodder or whatever. And so, you know, mankind ruined this a little bit here, and it ran through all of Europe and eventually got that feeling going. And now we've come back from that. It's taken us damn near 2,000 years to come back from that whiplash of bullshit that we got from that Hebrew God. But let's look at that chain thing. She's got, our Statue of Liberty has chains. Her feet are chained. Yeah, her feet are chained, and she's got weird looking feet too. I mean, I remember them from the from Ghostbusters. Remember when they get into it and do their thing and. She said one of her feet's like this big old clubfoot looking thing too. The other one kind of looks normal with a normalish sandal on it, and then one is this big old foot here, but this doesn't have the chain. Let me show you a picture of that. She's chained. So yeah, this is like her feet area and stuff, and you can see that right here she's chained, and it runs up through her dress and out back over here and around, and it's one of the links is supposed to be broken, but it's not in this depiction here than the original. And also way over here, there's that ugly club foot. Oh my God, she got a big old foot. But yeah, it's not like men feed on a woman or something. They made her somewhat androgynous, I guess, to try to appease some of the people that thought this would be a male deity, that it just a guy with long hair, kind of a Jesus thing. But let's go on. Let's see if we can find that broken chain. Yeah, we can find it right down here. There you can see that there it is, and the broken link that's there at the end of the chain where it's popped loose from it. And now we are broken loose from our freedom. This is, I guess, to signify our freedom. And France gave this to us to give light to the ships that were coming to France to come over. And that would be a beacon of light to let them know that, hey, it was all there. And they knew they had given us this, so we were all cool with them, with the French immigrants and things like that. This is having to do with after that we would still be cool with them after the fact that we did the Louisiana Purchase and things. But I digress. Let's go back to Mithra or other examples of this iconography. And surely we see the symbolism in Columbia Pictures, you know, through Sony, and that right there is their depiction of, again, Lady Liberty. And District of Columbia is Washington, D.C., so this tries to tie it all together, but you can see also how she's bringing the light. So surely when we see something like this, we can see the instant connection to it, and this being the Indian deity, and arm has been broken off now, but quite often it is a light bearer, also as a cup bearer, which also attaches you to Revelations, if you're familiar. And so you get this variation on. And uses a protector quite often in graves, on you know, mortuaries and sites like that, as being that that he will be the protector of you, that he, the sun himself, the sun Sol Invictus, will be a caretaker and a judge. Somehow, like blending together of the Greeks and Romans, you get Helios being blended in, and now you can see it here that Helios is this same entity, and it's why they drew it in. They were trying to draw in a religion to see if they could make it all one empire, and they found that the religion was what was holding them apart, because there was so much dogma in their religions. And it was their way that they mended with Greece, and they found that to be fantastic. So they thought, why don't we do it all over? So they started usurping other people's thoughts and deals. That's a reason that you see so much symbolism in the Catholic Church today, and all the paganism that they have, and how they adopted in the pagans. They just simply say that what we do is we Christianize it, if you will, or Catholicize it, and then it becomes their own little holiday. But maybe it turns out that Catholics are actually worshiping everybody else's stuff all at once, huh? You can see in these earlier depictions how he's a ruler, and he's back to holding a ruler, and the sun rays coming out of his top of his head, and he's shining forth from, you know, himself. He's the sun god, very much like Shamash. In many depictions, he's always there assisting, giving rulership and judgment whenever a king is receiving the circle of power, or the you know, the me, in this case, a Persian deity. And you can see here how he's, again, the man with the divine ruler that's here, helping to oversee the divine judgment. And so kings of yore were all indoctrinated into the church by the fact that this entity was overseeing it, and it was his divine judgment. You can see here the knights and the age that we're talking about, and how this still is in effect. So this would be way after Christianity has started, but not procured, and it's still not Christian. It's Mithraism. Quite often he's depicted as an overseer, like the sun, you know, that's always looking down upon you. Kind of that Santa Claus thing, kind of like what we believe about God and Jesus now. In this depiction here, you can see definite Phrygian caps are on these guys here, and this is meant to be Hermes with his caduceus, actually causing something to happen. This looks like an Amphalos, perhaps, like one of those belly buttons of the earth that the oracles use. And interestingly, here we do have a triad up in heaven. And so there's a female entity involved in it too. But in this depiction, she looks male, no boobies. But this is definitely a female in the moon. So here we have Inanna, that's the female moon goddess, and the sun, and they are the ones together with their child. So, by the way, the female entity in this is equated with Mother Earth and or Mother Goose. And you can see how she has taken control of the lamb and the bull and over the waters. It would be Aquarius. Here is the serpent dragon face that is showing throughout here with the wings hanging down as a woman. This is Lucifer, the morning star, Venus. And then here is Mother Goose. Instead of a cabbage patch, these people thought that swans and geese brought babies. They somehow, for a little while, had that attached into it. But an incredible relief here where she's the mother and giving her children fruits and the mother of all the big symbolism that's with that. In earliest depictions, he's just shown as being radiantly naked, and that he is wearing a Phrygian cap still at this point, but he's somewhat of a war god, and he is the bringer of light, carrying the torch. Now, if you look, he's coming up over a rock, and this is the Shamash thing, and this is where they're counting the days and where the sun is coming up over certain hills, mountains, rocks, things like that. So it's a calendar deity, a calendar entity, equating the sun and putting it all together at this point. And oddly enough, you always see him sacrificing this bull. I'm just going to show you a collage here, but you can see how he's sacrificing this bull. And whenever he does sacrifice the bull, how the snake is involved. There's a dog, quite often a goat. And so here he is sacrificing a bull. And in all these pictures, I want you to note how his legs are in the same position, that he's in the same position. Now he pulls the bull's head up and stabs it. He pulls the bull's head up and stabs it. You see this. Pulls the bulls up, stabs it in here. Same thing. Legs in this position. What is it with this leg position? Well, let me show you. And one of the keys to finding the constellation connection between this was the stars that are over there over his shoulder that are on his cloak still. And that you can still see there are a grouping of stars out over here. In Taurus, and it's in this exact same motif, and here he is sitting in that same leg posture, and it's just weird how he's always doing this leg posture. I mean, he's kneeling on a cow, but you could be doing this a bunch of different ways. Is everybody copying this one guy's picture, kind of like the Jesus thing, or is there more to it? Well, I found out there's more to it.